What's up, everyone? What's up? For y'all that don't know, we are doing a live right now about how to start a home-based grooming business. So we're going to start here in about 9 minutes. Soon as I add all my folks to it. So if you are a guest in the show, be sure to send an invite so I can go ahead and add you. Yeah. All right, there's Kate. Hello, 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 hello. I'm in Oklahoma, Midwest City, Oklahoma. Where's my guest at? There she is. Okay. We got a couple guests for y'all tonight.
You boss.
What's up?
Sorry, my girl is stuck to my side because of the gunshots. She's literally vibrating. And we shoot guns, but... Oh, I have the other dumb one right here. Hi.
You did a great nonprofit on that. Oh, that was definitely not a nonprofit. I got to feed these kids somehow.
Is the lighting okay? I'm trying to use my ring
light. Yeah, that's fine. Okay. Oh, is that Julie? Yep. All right, got Julie's invited.
Honey, you're okay.
All right.
Vibrating. Okay, I might have to have the headphones.
We got one more person we're waiting on, right? And Lynn.
Hey guys.
Or no, where I got Lynn in. Hey.
I'll either mute myself. I'm putting in my headphones now, but
I should have got my dang on headphones. So they Julie, keep barking, I know
because somebody keeps shooting guns.
Alexa, false. Oh, there she is. Hey, Julie.
Hey, finally figured it out. Sorry.
Yeah, I was just about to tell you. Listen.
Hi, Yorkie, Mom. Oh, yeah. Let's go. Oh, I might have to move to my grooming room, and that'll be a short travel. He won't shut up.
We're waiting on Quincy.
Shush. Shush. Quiet.
We got like 5 minutes left. Yeah, sorry to throw that little curveball of a question in there with y'all.
1 second, I might mute myself. He's being so mouthy.
He's like, I'm gonna be on there.
Right? He just wants his own phone.
Chef. No, he's barking at these gunshots. Somebody thinks they have unlimited ammo behind me, so.
Oh. That's fun.
That's expensive. Yeah. My girl's in my lap because she's also terrified.
Quincy must have fell asleep. Where's she at?
I don't see her.
She's not in here.
I don't know. I'm definitely not talented enough to check any chats or any other apps while on another app.
Well, yes, I'll check it. I'll be right back.
Okay.
I will literally go to my grooming room without my dogs if they keep barking.
Oh, wow.
I was like, perfect timing. Thank you, whoever you are, shooting guns.
Yeah. Yeah, right. Yeah, it's like when somebody decides to do fireworks a week before the holiday. It's always nice.
Oh, and she's like stuck real tight in my lap right now because.
Did I wear my leggings? No, I didn't wear my leggings.
I'm seriously, I still need to order some of those, but I don't. I've never groomed in leggings. I've only groomed in jeans.
Oh, really?
I just grew in basketball shorts. But yes, for y'all that are asking, this should be downloaded from TikTok. So after this is over with, I'm going to download it and then edit it and then upload it to my YouTube channel so you can watch it later. Episode one is on the YouTube channel, The Gun Show Groomer on YouTube. So there she is. Late. Invites.
Late.
Okay, there we go.
Not late. She's got 3 minutes.
On time.
All right. Yeah. So before we get started, hey, everyone, just start sharing this live so we can get more people on here. You know, I feel like we're pros at it now. We rocked it out last time.
You guys killed it.
Yeah.
There's Quincy.
There she is.
I'm not late. I'm still 3 minutes early. I was super the first one here last time, so I figured y'all were going to be late on me again today. So I just was trying to match all of you.
She wanted that bottom box.
Yeah.
He just wanted that bottom box.
Last word.
Yeah. But I was over here taking a nap. I was like, okay, I got to push through it. Got to go. So, did everybody groom today or what?
I don't work weekends.
No.
Just
me, huh?
I'm out of town. Getting rid of weekends, best thing I ever did.
I concur.
I used to groom all day on Saturdays, but now I'm to a half a day on Saturdays. And that's it. Chef. But my goal is to not work Saturdays at all.
Do it.
Yeah.
Literally, that was my goal, I used to moving only home do base. Like one every 6 weeks, and for the people who told me they could only come on Saturdays, oddly enough, I got rid of my Saturdays, and not one of them is not going to another groomer. They're still with me on a weekday. Weird, right? Only to do Saturdays, but somehow still are coming to me.
Well, you gotta understand too, though. I don't work on Wednesdays, and I do half day on Tuesday. So me working a half day on a Saturday is not a big deal. You know.
There you go.
I'm like, it is what it is.
Told myself I would never work a weekend. I have an Irish Wolfhound next Saturday. That's my only exception because I love the breed.
There you go.
I mean, when I worked at PetSmart, you had to work every Saturday. I hated it.
No.
Yeah, absolutely hate it.
I'm gonna lock my dog up, y'all.
Oh, and I got, like you already know, but I got banned on TikTok today. I don't know what happened. I said something wrong that made somebody mad, but yeah, I got banned and then I peeled it and then I'm back on. So I'm glad that we're able to get back on here.
Did one of your kids possibly pop on? I didn't watch your 5 minutes, but did one of your kids' faces at all come on?
No.
Because I got banned the other day on my other account because my little boy like wanted to share a message with people and he was sharing a message and I was laying right next to him. And they kicked him off within 5 seconds because they couldn't see an adult face. So I got banned but they banned me for like 10 minutes. And I was like, a kid could get right back on in 10 minutes, you dorks. Like,
yeah.
What is this?
They have a 10 minutes, no problem for them. No worries. Yeah. They will count it down.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't even have any kids here today. I was just showing videos of my chickens, like I always do. So.
That was the weirdest thing. And then, like, your salon tour, and then you got banned. I didn't know where you went. I was like, what?
We had no haters or anything. I'm just like, what happened?
Hey, Reg. So,
but, yeah, I missed the big old dog I got to groom. But I'm going to show a video. I'm going to make a video of it and post it later. So, but it is what it is. Reggie's in the house. What's up? What's up, Reggie? All right, well, I guess we can go ahead and get this party started. So, as y'all already know, we are, I like to call us a home-based grooming all-stars. I always feel like
all-stars. I consider myself that, but yes.
Yeah, pat myself on the back. I'm just kidding. So, we did episode one where we showed everyone why would you choose home-based grooming? If you missed that episode, go to the Gun Show Groomer on YouTube and check out the episode one, and it'll tell you all the pros and cons about home-based grooming. This episode, we're going to cover how to get started with home-based grooming. Now, there's probably going to be a lot of topics that we are not going to cover, or because honestly, the list can go on and on and on, but these four questions that we have here, I feel like are pretty good.
Did you get a fourth? I thought there
were
only three.
Yeah, I just added a fourth one.
He's like, hey, by the way, here's the fourth question. I'm going on.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. Literally 10 minutes ago.
Yeah, I just did. I was like, we need another question.
What's the fourth question?
Well, sorry. We're going to do the number two.
All right.
And that question is going to be the hurdles that you had during your build out.
Oh, yes. Okay.
I feel like that was pretty, that's pretty important. So, all right. So the first thing we're going to do is go through our introductions. And that way everybody can know who the heck we are. We also have two new people on our live today. What's up? So first of all, I'm Frazel, the Gun Show Groomer. And I've been grooming for 13 years. I started off at PetSmart. And I realized that, I mean, after I learned what I can learn from PetSmart, I left, worked at a vet clinic. And then I got burnt out. I quit, opened up a whole different career. I was selling Herbalife and had a nutrition store. And I did that pretty good. But then COVID happened. I shut my store down. And I came home and I said, you know what? If I'm going to be a home-based groomer, or if I'm going to come back to dog grooming, I'm going to do it my way. And that's when I started doing my home-based grooming business. And it kind of went from there. That's the quick story. The longer story is all over my profile and stuff. So, yeah, I'm going to pass this off to Julie so she can tell you her detailed story of how she got to – I mean, not Julie, Kate – Okay, that's the right one. Kate, you're
that far out. I was hoping it was a second, but yes, okay.
We're going this way. So pass it off to Kate.
Okay, so I started, I applied for an auto parts store, and they told me I wasn't old enough. And she said, but my aunt needs a bather. So I started there when I was 17. I've been grooming ever since. I had 1 6-month gap because the groomer I worked for, she had to declare bankruptcy and had to let me go. But then I started at this big salon, private, but bigger. And then 9 years into it, I decided I want to go home base.
That was a pretty quick story.
I wasn't prepared for that part. Shoot.
Well, that's the introduction. So how long have you been grooming?
15 years.
15 years. Okay. We got some veterans in the house. And where are you? Where are you located at?
Muskegon, Michigan.
Up there with the snow and ice. You
gotta love it. A lot of snow and ice. My husband's on the ice fishing right now. So.
I just thought that's something they did in movies. I've never seen that in person.
Ice camping, no problem, right?
Yeah. All right. Well, Kate, welcome to the party, and we're gonna pass it down to Julie. What's up, Julie?
Whew, I'm glad I didn't have to go first. Thank you. This is my first time here. So when you said my name, I was like, no, don't do that to me.
Me too.
hey, everyone. I'm Julie Becker. I have been a groomer for 17 years after graduating college and did the restaurant business and corporate and whatever. I got transferred to Wilmington, North Carolina, and I've been here ever since. Quit all that. Went to the dogs. I've worked in a shop and then did my apprenticeship at a kennel, worked at a vet's office. And then in 2010, I opened a mobile grooming business that was super successful. But then after having my daughter, I had multiple wrist and hand issues and the orthopedic surgeon told me that I should not be grooming full time. And so I tried supplementing my income with some network marketing, just like you. And then I got my real estate license and I still do that. But none of it has really felt fulfilling or in alignment. And so dog grooming has just kind of always been there. The cost of the van working part-time was not worth it. So I sold the van and I've been grooming at home ever since. And my clients just transferred from mobile grooming. I did do some competing along the way. I competed, I think, at 4 different competitions and got all my certifications and all of that. And then that was not the world for me. I don't know if any of you have done this, but traveling with 5 dogs from one side of the coast to the south side of the coast, from North Carolina to Florida, that was not fun, and I don't ever care to do it again. But I love grooming and grooming at home part-time and on my schedule, and the one-on-one with the dogs. It's just, it's truly the best, and my clients are honestly the happiest with home grooming. So I'm excited to be here. Thanks for having me.
Sweet. Yeah, I couldn't do the competition grooming at all. That's just not my thing. I do TikTok live, so I got enough people judging me, so I'm good. But we're gonna pass the mic off down to this lady right Sorry. Here.
My dog just took out my whole ring light. 1 second. can't make it up.
Lynn at Ask a Cat Groomer, and I've been a cat groomer. I did start with dogs almost 20 years ago, but I've been a cat specialty groomer for quite some time now. I taught with the National Cat Groomers Institute for the past 10 years, and now I have a home-based cat-only grooming and boarding business in New Jersey. And right now I'm in Arizona. I'm down at my friend Melissa Hall's salon, where we are teaching a pop-up cat grooming school. So we're at the midway point right now. So I'll be here for another week, and then I'll come back in April for another one. And then in March, I'll go to Australia to teach more cat grooming. So I see you.
You need an assistant. I'll be your assistant. I know Kelsey probably already claimed it, but me, pick me.
I can't wait. Oh, I just do, all cats all day, every day. And I love my little home-based business, mainly because I do boarding, and I like that we're there overnight on site, which isn't really a big thing in the boarding industry. And I am kind of a control freak, so I just found that being in my own space, having everything exactly the way I like it, nice and quiet, is definitely the way for me. So I really like my little shop, and I think we're at, this will be 5 years this fall that it's been open.
Oh, wow. Nice. So you already passed the hurdle of the small business hurdle.
Oh, yeah. Luckily, but we're actually closed right now. We start construction on Monday for a large renovation that we're completely gutting my grooming room, and we're building a level above it. So I am, fingers crossed, reopening in May is what we're hoping for. But so nice. A little bit of an expansion, I know.
Man, that's hard. That's it. Hard to plan for that.
But yeah, it's been tricky. I've been telling my last year that this was happening, and I'm still getting some text messages. I'm trying to schedule on your website, and it's not letting me. And I'm like, it's not like I've been telling you that I was going to.
People don't listen.
In one ear, out the other. They don't listen.
Yeah, so all my cat groomer friends are all busy helping my clients.
Well, man, well, I'd a round of applause for you, because I'm telling you, I could never do a cat. I can't.
I
got this fat cat over here, and he's just staring at me like he's going to kill me or something.
But it's a lot different when you only do cats, so like my whole salon is set up just for cats. Like there's no dogs that. And so it's just a different environment, and they do better. And then when that's what you niche down and really focus on, you become a specialist really quickly, really.
So you don't have any dogs at all in your salon?
No, none. Not as client. I have a personal dog. I don't groom her, though. I pay someone to groom her. She's a little toy poodle, diva. So I take her, a friend of mine grooms.
Oh, that's great.
That's amazing. Dog.
All right, well, Quincy, let's hear from you.
All right. Hey, guys. My name's Quincy. I live out in Utah, and I have been a dog groomer for almost 16 years now. I do not do cats. I actually give people who do cats mad props. So I started out with Petco. I managed for them, and I helped train multiple groomers and salon managers for them. in my district. That was my main thing, was training salon managers for them on customer service. My store was always the top of our district in sales and customer service. So that was something cool that I got to do with them. I got pregnant and had my little girl a little bit early. And due to that, I kind of on a whim went in home. And here I am coming up on 11 years in home. And I wouldn't change it for the world. I got to be home for raising my daughter. And now I have a little boy I raised too. They're 7 and 11. So for me, it was like the best of both worlds, taking my passion of what I love doing, but also getting to be a mom with them. I love being home-based because I get to do really cool things. Like, I work for Barkling, travel for their trade shows. I now work for Teton Grooming Expo. That's a new expo out in Idaho, working for them and everything. So I've been able to expand my career by being my own boss and being in home to be able to go and do these type of things, just kind of like Lynn, where she gets to go and teach amazing courses in Australia and down with amazing Miss Hall. That I just, yeah, I love what I do, and I love that our industry is so versatile and many areas to be in. So that's, yeah, that's kind of my little tidbit.
Well, congratulations on all your accomplishments, and everyone, congratulations on all their accomplishments, because, you know, what we do is not easy, but I wouldn't change it for the world, and I love it. Mm-hmm. All right, so we're going to roll right into our questions, our topics for tonight, and I'm looking at them right now, and I'm like, well, this question and that question could be rolled into one. So we all know, as home-based groomers, one of the first things you should do before you even decide that you want to become a home-based groomer is figure out if you can, like as far as permits and zoning requirements, or if your neighbors don't like it or whatever. So that's rule number one. A lot of folks skip that step. I did that, just letting you know. But we'll get into that in a second. But those are really important before you just jump into it. So learn from a lot of people's mistakes, y'all that are listening. And don't just jump right into stuff. You know, that's what this whole entire live is about. So we're going to talk about, where do you live, what kind of neighborhood you live in, and permit and zoning requirements. Did you have to worry about that? So I'll go ahead and go first. I live in Midwest City, Oklahoma. You don't know where that's at. That's literally next to the largest Air Force base that I know of in the United States, and right in the middle of the United States, Tinker Air Force Base. And I am in a residential neighborhood, but literally, I would say about 5 minutes or 10 minutes in going this way behind me. I know you can't, don't even know, but it's more rural. It's a very, like, I wouldn't say farming, but it's kind of a country, little country living, but not like crazy, crazy country. So it's right in the middle, and I love it. And I'm surrounded by a bunch of schools, so I'm not, like, I'm actually in a city. And as y'all know, I have chickens, so my city lets us have chickens, a certain amount. They said you don't have six, but I have too many.
You're pushing it.
So when it comes to permit and zoning stuff, when I first started, I just did it. I'll be straight up honest with you. I just did it. I didn't know anything. I said, well, screw it. I'll put a table in my, start grooming dogs. And then I was like, okay, well, I want to be more legit. So let me call the city and make sure that I can do it, you know? And so I called them. And before I can even finish the sentence, they said, no. I'm like, well, dang, you're a meanie face. Like, you just shut me down like that. Like, that was like rude. And so I was like, I'm not the type of person that just takes a no and just keeps going with it. So I did my own research, and I dug and dug and dug, and I actually found the law and the rules that state, yes, I can. Okay. So I went up to the city and I actually spoke to them, because, you know, face to face is way more important, way better than just over the phone. So I spoke to them face to face, and the lady straight up told me, she was like, look here, long as your neighbors are happy, we don't care what you do. I was like, what? She was like, you know, there's a boarding facility right in your neighborhood, right? I'm like, no, I didn't. Well, now I groom that lady's dogs. So, yeah. So my city, honestly, It's like they care, but they didn't care. What they care about the most is pissing off your neighbors. So I did go door to door and I talked to my neighbors and I said, hey, this is what I'm doing. Do you have an issue with it? They don't care. They didn't care at all. So that's, I'm still doing it. And I groom most of the people's dogs in my neighborhood. And I groom Chamber of Commerce members. I groom police officers' dogs. I groom state troopers' dogs. And it's just a really good community. But, you know, some places are way more strict than mine. Some places have HOAs. And if you're in an HOA, I can guarantee you're probably screwed. But I don't live in an HOA, and I would never live in an HOA. So that was my rundown of those kind of questions just smashed together. So I'm excited to hear what your issues have been, Kate, or whatever. So, yeah, let's hear from you, Kate.
Okay, so I wouldn't call myself country either, more rural, but I'm not like background dirt road country. I'm about 5 minutes any which way from a major grocery store. So I feel like I'm not far, but I've been told that I'm far from my previous clients because I'm about 20 minutes away from where I was. But as far as the zoning laws go, so I called the zoning department after I bought this house, after I started building my salon. After we figured it all out, I called the zoning commission because I had emailed and they just kept like back with just generic responses and everything. So I called her and she goes, what's stopping you? You. Like, what do you mean? What's stopping me? You might be. And that's why I want to know. Like, am I okay? She was like, we don't care either way as long as you don't get any complaints. But I only see two neighbors from where I'm at. I only have 2 acres. But directly next to me is a radio tower. Mm-hmm. And it's 14 acres. And so there's nothing on that side. I have a neighbor directly across that might complain, but they look like junkers and they have tons of cars out there. I wasn't worried about them. And then the person on my other side, their back faces me, like the back of their house, because I'm kind of on a corner. And they have a pool and everything. I have heard them twice over the summer in their pool. Like, they're not loud. They don't complain. I've never met them. So I just figured I was good to go. I didn't have to apply. I was technically, I think she said, I think you're technically zoned, but what's stopping you? So as far as zoning went, I felt safe, but it was kind of that gray area of grooming and like hairdressers and all that. It's the traffic they care about and the complaints. Yeah. And I'm one-on-one, so I don't have like 5 cars in my driveway.
Yeah, that's that was kind of like my issue too. Is, I mean, from what the rule was saying was basically you can't change the structure of the neighborhood. So that means no increased traffic, right? No signs in the yard, stuff like that. And that's exactly why I do one-on-one, because honestly, if you didn't know I had a grooming salon in my property, you can't tell. So
yeah,
but
and that's how it is.
I
did all of those. Yes.
Yeah, you did.
Your turn, Julie.
Knocked it out the park. Julie, what about you?
So I'm in Leland, North Carolina, right outside of Wilmington. So I'm about 25 minutes from the beach. Leland, it's a smaller town, very quickly growing, though. Brunswick County, where I live, is one of the fastest growing counties in the entire nation. I am extremely fortunate that as a real estate agent, I also know the zoning and I know what I can get away with and what I can't. And Leland is still kind of a free-for-all, if you will. Mm-hmm. We are regulated by the Department of Agriculture and they don't care. And the city of Leland does not care. So I got a house in the city limits on the corner of a cul-de-sac in a non-HOA neighborhood, and I can walk to Walmart and Starbucks. So I know that's crazy that I'm in the city limits, but it's kind of like what you guys are saying. As long as neighbors don't care, no one says anything. And since I only groom part-time and because I was mobile before, I offered a service where I pick up and drop off as well. So And about a third of my clients take advantage of that. So no one knows that I'm leaving my house to come back with a dog. And I park in my driveway or in my garage. So no one even knows that a dog is coming or going more than half the time. So, so it really wasn't an issue for me because it's not really regulated. And as long as no one is complaining, no one cares. They don't say anything.
Right. Yeah. So what about signage? Like, do you have it? Do you, because I think Kate just said that she doesn't want a sign.
Oh yeah, no, heck no. I don't want a sign. I don't want random people. No, I will. Exactly. I stopped taking new clients years ago. And the only ones I will take now are referrals from my favorite clients or other groomers that message me and ask if I'm willing to take on one of their clients.
Yeah,
that's it. So there's no sign. I'm like, nope, here's my address. It looks like this. And I'll send them a picture of my house. I'm like, there's no other sign. Like, no one would ever know what I do here. And I like it that way because I don't want people with, like, I don't groom large dogs. So I don't want somebody coming up with their 120 pound German Shepherd asking if I can groom their dog. Cause you're like, nope.
Today too.
Right. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly.
Right now.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right, Miss Cat Groomer, what about you?
So it was a little bit different than you guys. So I live in a very tight suburb, New Jersey. Like, my property is only a third of an acre. So we're all kind of right on top of each other. And my local municipalities all have different rules for zoning and things like that. So what I had to do was figure out which exact zone my house was. And then, so, cause there's different types of residential zones. And then I had to go look at the ordinances and see what they said. Now, according to the ordinances, I should have just had to apply for a conditional use permit, which is a pretty straightforward process. However, because it's up to the municipalities, there's like one guy in the town as the town planner that he is on a little bit of a power trip. So he denied my permit application and they had me get a use variance instead, which is twice as expensive, has more requirements. I had to have a hearing in front of a different board. It's called the Zoning Board of Adjustments. And basically it is, instead of going in front of the planning board to say, hey, this is what I'm trying to do and how it fits the exact ordinances, I had to go in front of a different board and say, hey, I know I'm asking to do something the ordinances say I'm not supposed to, but please let me do it anyway. But honestly, other than that one guy, everybody was really supportive. They passed. And honestly, if I didn't have my husband who is an attorney, I probably would have had to hire one in order for them to have someone in my side that their job is to interpret ordinances. Even though I could read them, I could understand them better than the people in the ordinance office, I still needed somebody on my side. So it can be an attorney, it can be an architect, an urban planner, an engineer, something like that. But they had to kind of say like, oh yes, like what she's trying to do, like fits all these things. I had to send certified letters to every property with 200 yards of my property, which is about 25 people and businesses. They all got an opportunity to come to the hearing. Nobody came. I put it in the paper. I had to show proof that I put it in the paper. They required me to get a survey, which was another $600. And the application for the use variance was $2,500. Plus, I got an extra bill for another $700 or $800 because the township attorney had to like do all this paperwork after they approved it. All so that I could have four cats sleep overnight at my house and groom a couple cats out of my garage. So did get all of my approvals. Wow. Yeah, it's been fun. And it's pricey, but crazy. It's all kind of they joke that I go, because at the time I didn't have a full-time job. I was working part-time remotely for National Cat Groomers. So even though they were giving me all this trouble, a lot of it was they just wouldn't respond to me. Like they just, I think, wanted me to just go away. And that's just so I would go down and I would sit in their office for hours, just sitting there. And so, like, they literally would come out and be like, "You're still here?" And I'm like, "Yeah, what time do you guys close today?" "Oh, 4:30? Okay, what time do you open tomorrow?" "9? Okay." Like, you know,
I'll be here with my coffee.
To make me go so away.
You basically had a hell of a time.
Yes. Well,
that
and
sounds with, terrible.
Oh, yeah, it was awful. But different ordinances apply to different municipalities. So I'm maybe 10, 15 minutes from a neighboring township. And they do not allow hairstylists and barbers and that kind of stuff to have a home-based business. So I could have easily been prevented from doing it if I lived in that township because they could have lumped me in with personal services. They most likely would not have permitted dog boarding because you're required to have outdoor areas for dog boarding in New Jersey. But cat boarding, obviously everything happens inside. They have limits on mechanical noises. I had to get approval from the water pollution. I had to show them my tub setup and my hair traps and tell them what products I was using. They wanted to make sure I wasn't, I don't know. I don't know what they think is happening at grooming salons. told me he wouldn't like it if there were weird cats wandering around in their neighborhood, like in the neighborhood. And I'm like, that would, it, that's not what happens. Like, what do you know? We're not just letting cats out.
It sounds like to me they were just trying to tell you no, and you just said,
"Oh yeah,
screw you."
Yeah, because it was a thing. I think it's because I wanted to do something that was against just okay, fill this out, write me a check, and here you go. Anything outside of that, they just didn't. They just don't want to help so much. Now, not every group is like that. Not every municipality is like that. But there are fines and there are, they can prevent you from having a business if they like caught me. And we do have, because we live in such a small suburb, they do have enforcers that go around. Like you wouldn't be able to have an accessory building. Like there's limits on accessory buildings. So like you couldn't have like, okay, I'm going to build, you know, like a little shed in the back and turn it into a grooming salon. Like that would not be permitted in my, so just, it really just depends. And somebody's asking about like the health department might need the septic company amount. It just depends on who's regulating what. Sometimes it's agricultural, sometimes it's animal control, sometimes it's the health department. Like there's a lot of different wheels in motion. And sometimes it just depends on who answers the phone that day.
Man.
Get everything in writing. Once I started emailing them after they would say something to me in person, I would email all of the people in the office that I was supposed to be dealing with and be like, as per our conversation, all of a sudden they started saying yes a lot faster.
Man, nice. Oh man.
Just tell her yes and she'll stop emailing us.
They joked that if I came one more to the office, I'd get a mug. Like I was there all the time.
Frequent flyer miles.
Seriously. Oh man. Get yourself a W-2 because you're like working there.
Pretty much.
Hey, so wow. For everyone asking questions, we're going to have a Q&A section at the end. So if your questions aren't getting asked through our conversation, just save them for the end and just blast them out there at the end, okay? So, all right, Quincy, what's up with you?
Okay, first off, I'm just going to say holy dedication, Lynn. Holy dedication. Amazing. I think out of all of us,
you I'm very put through
a ringer, my friend.
You're not saying no to me without a reason.
Yeah, yeah. I love it. So I have two home-based salons. I started out in a different city and then moved. My first city in that home was... Oh, hey, dog. I was like, my dogs are not
Hold
here.
Hold on. No, it's my idiot barking at gunshots.
That's perfect. I don't mind. So at first, when I opened in home, I didn't have any problems. There was already a lady who happened to groom in my city. So she did all the work years and years ago. She was she's retired and probably passed by now. But for me to open was easy. I called the city saying, hey, I am building this home. I want to open a grooming in it eventually one day because I didn't know I would do that. And they're like, yeah, you just need to be registered with the city and the state and you can open. You can't have a sign in your yard and you're good to go. Like that easy. However, I did live in an HOA. So I did have to present my business to my board. And out of the 5 members on the board, only one of them had a cat. The rest had no animals. And the HOA president, who is still the HOA president there,
hates dogs. So I'm like, cool. So I like present this to them and they like ask me questions like, how many people were going to be there and all that stuff. And I told them it's one-on-one, all this stuff. And they're like, yeah, as long as you keep the dogs off of your neighbor's property, because I was the last house of the HOA. So as long as I kept them off of my neighbor's property, they didn't care. So I got approved. But luckily there were like four other home businesses that were service-based that I was like, if you allow them, there's no reason why I can't be allowed. And I am like Lynn too. If you tell me like no, or like you give me a fight, I'm going to also fight you back if I know I am in the right and that I deserve to also have a business. Now, I moved a couple of years ago, like 20 minutes north, and that city as well, there was a home groomer, and she was told she could only be in an outbuilding, but the house I purchased did not have an outbuilding. So I contacted them and they're like, oh no, we just let you do whatever. Like, we'll have a city inspector come and check it. So you just let us know when you're done. And we'll go from there. So for me, in my next home, I set my salon up and everything. And I called them and I said, hey, I just want to let you know I'm set up. I'm opening on this date. And I've been there for a couple of years and I have still yet to see them. So I live in a, I don't know if it's because I'm a right to work state or what, but it's been very easy here for me, at least in the county that I'm in. But I can say my friend, a county over, literally had to do what Lynn did. She had to fight to open her business. Even when she lived in like agriculture land, in like farmland, they still fought her and everything. So I just was really lucky. So like after hearing Lynn's story, I'm like, damn, I really was lucky. So mine was really easy. And the same with this city. They had rules of like, I'm only allowed to have one employee in the city that's non-family. The other city I worked in, I could have two employees that were non-family. So they did have certain rules like that, but their rules were really like reasonable, I feel like, for being a home-based business. And their biggest concern was the same as most of you, is the traffic flow to your neighborhood. They just didn't want me like bringing in a ton of people, especially because the city I live in, it's a five-mile strip. And we have like one stoplight in our entire town, or nothing. So they just like to keep it their cute little quaint town. But I live so close to the exit that it doesn't even matter. So mine's pretty easy.
Wow. So basically, to answer a lot of people's questions and stuff, the reason why these neighborhoods are zoned the way they are, residential versus commercial, and our real estate lady, I'm pretty sure she could, you know, clarify all this stuff, is because when people live in a residential area, they want to live as a neighborhood, calm, quiet, peaceful. And then in the other, in commercial zoning, it's businesses. It's all types, like all types of stuff, loud noises. So they don't want to bring the loud noises and traffic to a calm, quiet neighborhood. That's the whole point of these zonings. And so that's why we can't have signs in our yard, or this is why they're concerned with increased traffic. And this is why most home-based groomers are one-on-one. And it's all about just keeping the structure of the neighborhood. You don't want to mess up the neighborhood. And that's why, even if the city allows you to do all this stuff, and they got the laws and it's all set in stone, I guarantee you this, if you get enough neighbors complaining, that law will get changed. I can almost guarantee it. So before you go, even before you go getting permits and zoning and all that crap, knock, knock, knock. Hey, I'm so-and-so. This is what I do. I've been doing it for so-and-so years. Like, shoot, bring him some brownies or something. I don't know. But communicate with your neighbors. That's, your neighbors are your number one thing. You don't want to piss them off. You do not want to piss them off. Like, ever. So, I have chickens in my backyard, and my neighbors get free eggs. So,
I want to be your neighbor.
Yeah,
I want free eggs.
I just dropped off like a couple dozen eggs. So,
first,
but
before I checked, I was like, "Hey, every neighbor," because I had just moved into the house, so I didn't know the neighbors very well. So before I even put in my application, I went and I made these little flyers and I went around all the neighbors near me to say, like, "Hey, this is what I'm thinking about doing. If you have any questions, give me a call." That way I can kind of like see where they're going to be anybody to give me a really hard time. And I did have one gal I thought was going to give me a hard time because she did not like that there was a daycare on the other side of her property. But that person actually went to the state and got the whole property rezoned, and they were able to they went and circumvented the whole thing.
Holy crap.
And changed the ordinances because of what that did. Oh yeah, it's all scandal. It's all scandal.
Damn. Wow. Wow. Well, I guess that brings us to our next part. We're going to talk about, let's see. What do y'all want to cover first? Advertising or build out hurdles?
Let's do advertising.
Advertising.
Okay. So advertising. How to advertise your home-based business. We all know word of mouth is everything. That's literally key. All you got to do is groom one dog or one cat to the right person. It's going to spread like wildfire. So what I've done differently, though, I'm silly. Y'all know that. I make really silly rap videos, okay? I rap about dog grooming. I've been doing it for a very long time, and they're very silly. They're all over my YouTube channel. And so I'm rapping about dog grooming, and for some reason, it catches people's attention. So I post that in all the garage sale groups and for sale groups all over Facebook. That's how I got most of my business, because they're just like, whoa, this is different. You know what I'm saying? I feel like you have to do something that makes you stand out. Something that's, you know, that's just like, wow, you know, so many people are afraid to put themselves out on a, like, you can't be afraid to sell yourself. I know that sounds weird, but seriously, people want to know, who's grooming my dog? Who is this person? Who am I dropping my dog off to? Especially if you're a home-based business, because think about it. These people are dropping their dogs off with someone in their backyard. Like, you know, it's kind of sketchy sometimes. So my goal when I advertise is to try to build that trust up as much as possible. And so that's what I did. I made silly rap videos, a bunch of silly videos, and I posted all the for sale groups multiple times a week. I would flood it like crazy. And then I would back off for like a week and then flood it again. And that seemed to work. And like I said, once you groom a couple people's dogs or cats or whatever, then the word of mouth spread and it was golden. Oh, another thing I do is reviews. So what I do is every time I have a new client that comes to my salon, I typically give them about a day or two, and then I message and I'm just like, hey, you know, I enjoy grooming Fluffy. I hope everything was great. I try my best to please, you know, just give them this spiel, you know, everything. And I said, if you're absolutely happy with the groom, please do me a favor and go on my Facebook page and write a review. I tell them that one time, and I never tell them again. I don't want to feel like a salesman where I'm just like beating them up saying, hey, write me a review. I say it once and leave it alone, you know? And sometimes, actually a lot of times, people literally wait months before they write a review because they just forgot about it, you know? And so a lot of people seem like they're afraid to actually ask their clients to write a review, and I'm not afraid. So that's how I did my advertising. There was no sign in my front yard. There's no t-shirt that says come to the gun show grooming. I literally just put myself out there all over social media, and then word of mouth spread like wildfire. And that's how I got here today. Pretty simple. You got any rapping videos?
Oh yeah, tons of them. Go check me out. I'm really good at it too. But so advertising wasn't really difficult for me because I went from a salon that I worked at for 9 years. Can you guys hear me? My headphones are being funky. Okay. I worked at a salon for 9 years and I built up quite a clientele. I was also manager. So I would text, remind everybody every day with my personal phone. So they all had my number. And when I left, I wasn't allowed to tell people, and I didn't. But I also didn't sign a non-compete clause. Ever. Not that I was trying to take people, but if they wanted to come to me, it wasn't my fault.
Right.
And so the hard part was I had a lot of upset clients that I didn't tell them. I was like, I was asked not to, and I respected her wishes for not telling everybody I was leaving. I gave her a 4-week notice, and in my first 2 weeks, I started booking solid. I had 160 clients in my first year. And that's one dog or four dogs or whatever they have. That's people.
Yeah.
And so I did really well that way. I advertised a little on Facebook and found some people locally, or it was word of mouth, like, hey, my friend lives out by you now and she's grooming. Go to her. And I've been doing well since. I really don't take new clients anymore, and I've barely been open 2 years. Not quite two. So advertising for me wasn't hard.
Yeah.
I didn't really have to, and I got lucky in that sense.
I do want to point out something. I hate these non-compete clauses. If you're a business owner, I find something shady about them. I don't feel like you can't say that's my client. Like, I don't know.
You can't own your client.
That's what I'm saying.
That's a misunderstanding of what a non-compete agreement is, though.
You're an attorney, people. Tell me.
So it isn't that you're owning a client. Well, first of all, so separate from the non-compete agreement is you are not supposed to be taking business assets, which is the client's information, because the business has paid to market, have their rent, all those things, and the business owner should have been protecting. So the fact that, Kate, you said that you were encouraged to text them from your personal number, that's a fail on the business owner. That has anything to do with a non-compete. Non-competes typically are in exchange for something. So they're actually very common in certain industries. So one of my good friends, his wife is an oral surgeon. And when she purchased a business, there is a non-compete with the owner, the previous owner of the business, that person wouldn't open another business within so many years, within so many miles, because they were literally selling this business to them. And so they were like, you can't work within this area. Other instances of non-competes are when they are paying for all of your training, and it's meant to be like trade secrets. And so a lot of it is they've either provided you a lot of training, or they're giving you access to a lot of insider information that they don't want you to use with a direct competitor. In grooming, it's mostly used incorrectly. What most businesses really want is a non-solicitation clause, which means that they are not going out and soliciting existing clients using business asset information. Now, if you, as a new business owner, put yourself out on social media, you're paying for advertising, you're putting the time in, and those people find you, that has nothing to do with any of those clauses, and that's what you should be doing. So I worked for one groomer or one vet, and the groomer was like going out on maternity leave, but she printed out a stack of client records. With her, right. And then we all knew she wasn't coming back. Really. It was just like, yeah, that's not how it should be working. But so it's really not appropriate in most businesses, and I have refused to sign them. So if someone comes to me and I'm already a groomer, well, you're not teaching me anything. You're not offering to cover, you know, like if they want to negotiate with me and pay me a bonus to not.
Uh-oh, your sound.
Meet those requirements? Out. Well, I'm open.
You're cutting out, Lynn.
All right. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Yes.
How about now? Sorry.
Yes.
I don't know why I have. But it's.
No, she's cutting out.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
No,
but the whole like non-compete clause, I was afraid of her coming after me because her business is almost gone now. She solely blamed me for tanking it, for leaving. Yeah. And that's not fair. It wasn't my fault.
Poor business management isn't your fault, though.
Yeah.
No, it wasn't my fault, but she straight up blamed.
I know Lynn was on her still, roll.
She's gone.
Yeah. She'll be back, y'all.
Keep going.
She'll be back.
literally, when it comes to like all legal things, Lynn and her husband are pros in our industry. Yeah. Like, if anyone ever has questions, they truly. Kelsey, while you're on here, I know they have like a business name. Like, they do, like, is it Groomer Docs? Like, they have so many things to protect you. Oh, she's back. If you can add her back on.
Yeah.
So sure. They're just fantastic.
Thank you. I'm trying to figure out how to just do that now. Anyway, Julie, go ahead and go with your stuff while I figure this out.
Yeah, so the transition to home grooming, that was really easy because I had an established mobile grooming business of 11 years when I sold that van and transitioned to home grooming. So all of my clientele came from that, and I didn't really lose anyone. So, but when I was working at the vet's office, I had the classic, most of them needed to be on ACE Promazine, they were in poor condition and that sort of thing. And I wanted to do the competition grooms, and I wanted the pretty grooms. And so what I did to advertise for the dogs that I wanted, I searched I would go in the lobby of the vet's office, and anytime I saw a really cute dog, I would just approach the owner and say, hey, I'm the new groomer here, and I'm really interested in getting into this side of grooming. I would love to offer you a full groom on your dog if you'll let me take pictures and just sit outside the vet's office for the day at the coffee shop and pass my card out. And people were like, oh, yeah, free groom? Heck yeah. So I would pick the cutest, sweetest dogs. And that got me, I did that 3 times. And that got me literally all the pretty dogs I wanted. And then we reached a point where I was booked out 6 months. I had 2 assistants. We couldn't find another groomer. And one thing led to another. So that's when I went mobile. And the vet couldn't find another groomer to replace me. And she had so many people asking specifically for my number that she just gave them my number. So, so they went with me mobile. But also when I went, you know, not everyone wanted to pay those prices.
Uh-oh. Now she's frozen.
She didn't want to raise the prices.
Okay, you're back.
Okay, am I back?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Are we okay?
Yeah.
Okay. So another part of getting the clientele when I went mobile looking for new clients, you know, because not everybody from the vet's office wanted to pay the mobile prices. They still wanted me, but they didn't want to pay those prices. And I was like, well, sorry, these are my prices now. So I printed out pictures of me with the, of course, the prettiest dogs and pictures of the cutest dogs. And I made a little flyer on an 8x11 and framed it, and then went with a stack of business cards to every local. I went to all the vets and introduced myself and just established a relationship with them and asked them, what's your opinion on how you like to see your clients' ears cleaned? How do you feel about anal glands? How do you feel about this? And just asked them specific questions to build that relationship with the vet, so that when I had a client that was their mutual client, I could say, well, I know that Dr. XYZ prefers this, so this is what I'm going to do. If he wants something other than that, just let me know or have him call me. And so, and then they would let, because they didn't have a groomer, they let me put my 8x11 little framed thing up on their desk and then a stack of business cards. I did that with both of the other vets in town. And then I also went to the local, like there was a self-service dog wash that didn't have a groomer and they didn't want a groomer. It's just a self-service dog wash and another pet supply store. It's like a mom and pop shop that was never going to have a groomer. So I built relationships with those people. So we just referred people back and forth. And that's how I built my clientele. And then within a year of being mobile, I stopped taking new clients. And it's been that way for 12 years now. I only take referrals if I want them.
That's the way to do it right there.
Yeah, it's a great way to be.
Like every now and then, I always post on Facebook. I'm like, okay, well, I'm not taking any more new clients because I'm like, I'll be booked out literally like 2-3 months. Yeah. But then all of a sudden people start rescheduling or canceling or something happened. So I got all these openings. I'm just like, well, screw it. I'm taking new clients again. And I'm just like, as of right now, I just like, shoot, I'll just take anybody. And if you want to be on my schedule, you got to be prepared to just, book out. You know,
yeah.
I got a lot of people that book out, you know, 5, 6, 7 appointments ahead. So, I mean, it works.
Yeah. But I you know, I don't think there's.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I don't think there's a wrong way to do it. I think it's ultimately what does your lifestyle require and how do you like to do it? Some people, they book for the entire year and they love that. I personally, and I'm like, I think I'm maxed out on clients because I like my flexibility. I'm a single mom. I'm also a real estate agent. I also like my solitude and my quiet time. So if I have a slow week, I'm like, freaking cool. Block Monday and Friday right the hell off. Right? Like, you know, but so there's really no wrong way to do it. And I think that's one of the greatest things about being a home groomer and being self-employed is that you can. If you want to work Saturday and Sunday and off Tuesday, Wednesday, you can. If you want to work Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, off Friday through Monday, you can. It's up to you.
No hashtag boss status. What about you, Quincy?
So for me, like, key starting out was I made a Facebook and Instagram, right? I mean, I think that was key for starting. I'm a big social media freak. I think it's a very important thing to have in your business. So I started those out, got those up, and then got my business listed on Google. I am probably one of the only home groomers who has their business address posted. I don't care. I've never in 10, almost 11 years, no one has ever showed up to my house or knocked on my door. Nobody has come after hours. It is about putting your rules and everything in place. Hey, Christy, it really is. I literally say these are my hours of operation. When they would go to my pages, I would have things there for people to understand. This is how I operate. People wanted appointments at 5 o'clock. Sorry, I'm close at 5 o'clock. My phone is off. I turn off my work phone. You don't bug me after hours, and my clients respect that about, like, that it's my time too. It's life balance. You should have a life balance. So I get that freaks some people out. Some of my friends just don't, and that's totally fine. But I do because I want my clients to know where I'm at. I have cameras for my business. I have things to protect me. I Google every person who came to my house at the beginning. So I was prepared. I had all the things in there, but I did social medias, Googles. I had clients who had followed me from Petco. I'm a very people face person. So I would see my clients out at Walmart, Target, whatever. And I had my business card and be like, oh my gosh, I miss you and Bella. Like, did you know I opened my own business? Here's my card. I'd love to see you again. Not one of them never called me. They all came. So I had all of them that followed me. And then I was like, you know what? I would love your help when they'd come. I'm building up my business. You know, I've been grooming your dog for years at Petco. Would you mind going and dropping me a review on my Google? So they would go and leave me a Google review. And so people would see it. Also, I grew up a city over. So that kind of helped posting on my own personal Facebook page, being like, hey, people who've known me my whole life, this is my new adventure. I'm super excited. And they were all excited about that. I also joined the Utah Groomers Facebook page, and I connected to that. We have like monthly dinners, like hangouts, all these type of things. So I would network with people, and I would have groomers send me business that they're like, I'm not taking them. So finally I got to a point after posting just my basic grooms that I was doing. I'm not like, I don't do what Julie did. I don't do contests. I didn't want the foo-foo frilly dogs. I love being a pet groomer. Like, I love the basic pet, like, this is just a 5 all over and a cute face, or this is like a 3 all over and like a mohawk. Like, I like that stuff. Like, that is like my jam, and I'm okay with like that. So because of that, it got me to a point that I actually like booked out, and then I gave back. So I give back to my other Utah groomers, the city I moved into. All my clients followed me, and I booked the girl around the corner within 2 months, and she's not taking new clients either. So I'm all about networking and social media. Like, that is key. People are on social media. They see things. They want to know what's going on. And I put my face out there. This is one thing I tell groomers. Don't hide your freaking face on your socials. I cannot stand. And it happens. I guarantee a bunch of you. If I went and looked at your socials right now, it's dog, 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 cat, cat, cat. Here's a shampoo I use. But where's your face? Not you on here, not on the lives. But I know your guys' accounts. I stalked you. But if people see your face too and get like the presence of you, like, that helps too. Like, I literally like have posted
Like, we have an amusement park down the road, and I took a picture of my kids and I while we were there saying, look at us enjoying our day off and all of this stuff. And then I'd post and be like, when I was not, because I booked for a year out. My clients haven't taken new clients. November 1st, they give me what they want their schedule, and I fill them out for the full year, and that's it. They're set for the whole year. We're good to go. So with that, like, I'll put, like, before that, I would post, like, hey, guys, like, I have, like, 4 openings left for the month. Message me to get them. You guys, I had, like, 20 openings left for the month. It was lying. I get it. It's fine. Or I'd be, like, space is limited, and people were like, oh, my gosh, I need an appointment. And they freak
out. Works every time.
Yeah, it works every time. And so every time. I, like, really started getting to the point that I really was booking out, that my clients were like, oh, I want to schedule, like, the next 3 out. And I'm like, are you serious? You really, like, who wants to, okay. Like, and so at first it freaked me out. And then all of a sudden I had clients like, can I just book for the whole year? And then I did it. And then I started weeding out the people who didn't, like, match my soul. Like, cause I didn't really know what a soulmate client was really, or, like, you know, your perfect fit until a little later on in my career. And I slowly started figuring out, like, what I really wanted for my business, what I wanted with my kids, and, like, put that into my marketing plan. And I pushed it pretty much all through social, like, hey, like, here's my job form. If you want to schedule with me for the year and you're a current clients only, they'd go do it. And then now I have literally, I went from doing like 300 dogs, 300 to 400 dogs a month to, I think I'm only at 75, 80, and I'm making more money by doing it because I've upped my prices really high. And I have taken the priority of being with my children 100% more. And yeah, and it's all just been based off doing social media, Google reviews, and connecting with local groomers and showing my face to my clients because they want to see the inside of what's going on. Like, if someone asked me to go live, like how you go live on, like, your, I mean, I think, are you live every day you groom?
Just about.
Yeah. Like, pretty much. You're giving your clients something to see, right? Like, mm-hmm. what you're doing. And so they feel more comfortable too being in, like, bringing their pet into your home because you're taking yep. care of their baby. So even a simple, like, video of, like, here I am with Fluffy today, like, look at what we're doing, yeah. means so much more than just somebody who is posting a finished fancy groom every day. Yeah. Like, you will stand out so much more in that department if you do. Man, I feel like I ranted for a long time, you guys. I'm sorry. I'm really passionate about social media stuff.
You're fine. You're fine. Stuff.
Yeah, I think that, you know, people just, they want to see the personal side of dog grooming. You know, like you said, like, people are so afraid to put their face out there. Like, put your face out there. Let them know. Like, when me and my wife celebrate our anniversary, I posted that right on my business page. Hey, we're going to, and we post each other at the beach, just, you know, drinking, just relaxing. But they just want to know that, you know, like, we're human, and that's kind of all part of it, you know, but that's part of advertising, at least on a small business level. When you're like, you know, PetSmart and Petco and those people up there, clearly they're not down here with us on a personal level. So there's different clients that goes for them versus for us, and that's perfectly fine. But here as a small business level, I feel like what we have over everybody else is the fact that we can be more personal with our clients. See?
Oh my God, that I'm going to kill him. Right there.
So, all right. So our last question, and I threw this at everybody at the last minute.
Yeah, so you ain't got to. Wait, huh? Wait. Lynn didn't go.
Oh, she, my bad. Sorry.
It's all good. We got you.
Yeah, because you disappeared for a bit, and then you came back, and I'm all over. Okay.
I'm in a different spot. I've messed y'all up.
Chevy, shut it. I messed
everybody up. But no.
All right, Manuel, how do you advertise?
So I feel a very different approach to advertising, because kind of Quincy was talking about, like, soulmate client, like, ideal client. So I specialize in a very, very specific type of cat owner. I love Persians and exotic short hairs, and I want to see them around every 6 to 8 weeks. So I had to identify a very targeted demographic that I wanted. And to be totally honest, I don't want word of mouth. I have found that a lot of the clients that I want because they've got Persians and exotic and all these really lovely, beautiful, purebred, well-bred cats feel stigmatized when they talk to their friends and family because they didn't adopt, you know, their pets. And so a lot of times my best clients don't know anybody that have another cat that I want or is the other type of client that I want. So I really found that I did start with a lot of vet networking, and it worked at first because I wanted to fill my books. And so I was getting a lot of vet referrals from cats that could not be groomed by anybody else. I took it kind of one step further because there's about 30 vets within 45 minutes of me. And so I had a whole spreadsheet of every vet, the hours they were open. I had because a lot of them had office pets like cats. I knew what their names were. And I would go in and I would schmooze the front desk people because they were the ones that were going to be talking to the owners. They were the ones that were going to, that I would be talking to when I called and would ask for information. And when I first opened, all my clients, I require that they're up to date on vaccines and that they've received a veterinary exam within the past 12 months. So in order for me to get that information, when I was first open and I was a lot quieter, I would call them. I would call the vet on the client's behalf so that the front desk kept hearing about me. So I would call and be like, hey, this is Lynn from Catnaps Cat. And, you know, we have a mutual client and I'm just calling to confirm some things. Do you have a second to chat? And a lot of times they would get to know me. They knew my name. They knew who I was because I was calling all the time. So it became really easy. I didn't even have to bring anything by. And then when I was getting a lot of referrals from certain vets, I would bring baked goods. I would send thank yous. And then if there were certain vets that I wanted to have them refer me more, I would go bring them thank you gifts, even if they hadn't sent me anybody. Because then they were like, oh, somebody in this office is referring her. So I guess we should do it too. And then they would start sending me referrals. But once I started getting busy enough that I really wanted to niche down to my very specific Persian clients, to me, Google Ads was much more effective. And I got way more control over my ROI, my return on investment. I could pretty much calculate because I had boarding also. So I was also looking at boarding clients because I do a lot of boarding for non-Persian cats, obviously. And so after the first like year or two, I could calculate through my Google ad, how much did I spend and how much did it turn into? And it came down to, I would spend $15. That $15 would turn into a yearly minimum of $325. And so that was basically the baseline for my return on investment. So obviously if I had $15, and I gave it to somebody and they gave me $325 back, obviously that's a good exchange and I would do it all day long. But I knew that if I needed to increase my clientele, all I had to do was increase my budget. So I was spending more $15 in order to get the number of clients that I wanted. And then when I got really full, I would just lower the budget back down or I'd put it on pause. And it allowed me to control my growth in a way that I really liked, because I don't like just having other people refer me, because they never seem to refer me the cats that I really want to work with. It's always like, oh, my cat lives out back with the raccoons. Can you shave them?
And they refer you the ones they don't want to do.
Yeah, exactly. And I'm like, no, I want the big fluffy Persians that no one else is bathing. Give me those kitties. So,
all right, my dogs are about to go buck wild. My husband just got home. I might pause.
You can mute yourself. You don't have to turn the off. So anyway, so I found that to me, Google Ads worked a lot better. Now I do have social media. I don't use them actively. I mean, obviously it's a little bit different with TikTok because I kind of fell into that, but I was kind of busy way before that. So I do have an Instagram. I do have a I do have a Facebook. I don't use them super actively because I found that the demographic I was looking for, they were on those platforms, but they weren't using those platforms to seek out new service providers. They were using those platforms more for entertainment. And I found that me trying to push organically to new potential clients just wasn't a good investment of my time and money versus Google Ads. And that's it.
Rocking it out. You can get off here. Go somewhere. Come inside and wipe his muddy paws all over me. Great. Really? Gotta love it.
Cat, muddy paws.
Was that Boston or Stinky?
That was Stinky. That was the one that had the seizure.
How's he doing?
Yeah. He's a whole lot better now. He just vibrates all the time. He just like
vibrates for.
Yeah. So
what did Jackie say?
She said that he was vibrating before.
Before the seizure.
Yeah. Yeah. So do y'all want to go straight into our Q&A or do you want to go over the build out stuff?
Q&A.
It's pretty simple for build out, so we can go to Q&A. I didn't have much problems besides my own issues of building it.
All right, so this is officially now our Q&A section. You know, I figure we cover a whole lot of stuff. And we've had like the same 70 people watching this whole time, so that's good. That means we held y'all's attention for long. So if you have questions, spit them out right now. And
there was a question before, and Quincy kind of touched on it. We saw it in the comments, and I forget who posted it, but somebody was saying, how do you get people to not harass you outside of business hours? And Quincy had mentioned that she doesn't really have people come. I do have a sign. Mine is more because I have people who travel from a further away, and they've never like been to my neighborhood, like never been to my house. So I do have a small sign out front. But I found when I'm doing my website, my advertising, pushing, like my emails, everything like that, I don't mention to them that I'm actually a home-based business until I've already either chatted with them or I've already basically vetted them as a potential client and I'm offering them an appointment. And then I say, okay, and this is the address and this is where you're going to go and I'm going to come meet you out front. And then I have a little video and I have to change it once I reopen after my renovations. But I made it during COVID. Basically shows how they would come to the house and they'd pull out front and like where I would go. And it's really cute, but I don't make a big deal about the fact that I am home-based, just that I am this, you know, private groomer and I'm going to be the answer to all your problems, you know, things like that. And then it's like at the very end, it's like, oh, by the way, this is my house. Don't bother me. And I've noticed that, you know, like it works pretty well.
Yeah.
I've had people knock on my door, but it's usually because they found me and they saw my hours and just skipped over the by appointment part and just showed up. But it was always during business hours.
That's good.
And I do the same. Most people don't read.
Most people don't read.
They don't read. They're like, I tried to Google your address, but I couldn't find it. I said, yeah, my address is not on Google. Like, I send you my address whenever, like, it automatically sends it to you. But anyone there out the other, but for me, I have a separate entrance for people to come in and out of, so no one should ever be knocking on my door. So when they do knock on my door, I do kind of get a little irritated because I have 5 dogs, and when one barks, they all bark. But
yes,
it is what
it
is.
I have a flag out front. It's just a blue flag with a paw print on it. So some of my clients that aren't familiar with my area, it's 55 yeah. miles an hour on our road.
Oh, wow.
And they'll pass it always. And so I have one little, like, not little. It's like a size of a regular American flag. And then my American flag out there. And that's their only indication. My husband wants me to get a sign. I told him, no, I don't want people to know what I do. It's just, we love dogs, right?
Yeah. And I love your setup, Kate, by the way.
I love it, too.
I do the same as Lynn, too. I was going to say, like, I just post that I'm a one-on-one groomer. By appointment only. And I feel like that's been very beneficial too. And I've had some people who like, when I said I'm on Google, they'll be like, oh, I see it's a house. Are you in a house? And then I'll like educate them and be like, yeah, I have been grooming for X amount of time. This is what is included in your service. It's a nice, like fear-free zone for your pet, more calming for them and stuff like that too. And I feel like that's been very beneficial when they like do realize it's in home as well.
Yeah. We had a question on here, LLC, sole proprietor, or S-Corp. I don't know about the rest of y'all. I know the person to ask is Lynn.
I'm LLC.
So
Lynn.
I'm a S-Corp. And the reason why I'm S-Corp is because my CPA told me to be one. And that's the easy answer. But, yeah. I don't understand tax stuff. If taxes were simple, then I mean, I don't know. I wish they were simple. Yeah.
So maybe you can explain better, or whoever wants to jump in on that.
She was going to jump in.
Yeah, I can help with this. So I started with an LLC, and there's a lot of tax benefits when you first start in business as an LLC. And fun fact, when you create an LLC, when you file your taxes, you can actually file as a sole proprietor, and you can change that up a little bit when you file. Confirm that. This is in North Carolina. Confirm that with your attorney and or CPA. I get there's a gray area of who to ask there, whether it's an attorney or a CPA. A lot of times they overcross a lot. But what's that?
Yeah, they have tax attorneys. There's a separate tax specialization in law school that you can go to a tax attorney.
Yeah, see, that's all like, woo! But for my online, for my digital business where I'll be creating courses online, that's not for just North Carolina. I also was advised to create an LLC for that because, again, there's more tax benefits when you initially start as an LLC. And then they said, as we move forward, we'll change that to an S-Corp. And the difference is like, my local business here in North Carolina has one LLC, and then my digital business, which is global, there's something on the back end paperwork-wise. Again, I let professionals handle this. I did not do this on like the online thing and do it myself. I had a professional do it to make sure that that LLC covers all of the states and Canada and other countries globally. There is a difference in how you create your LLC. So like if you're on a state line, and you might service, like if you're on the corner of four states and people might drive from a different state, make sure that your attorney covers you to service people in those states.
I never thought of that.
That's complicated.
I've never been close enough. Always, I'm Michigan by the lake.
So my advice here is to just always contact, confirm what you want to do with both your CPA and an attorney and make sure that you are covered for whatever your business plan is. And it just know that it might transition to start as one thing and then move forward into something else as you grow.
So what I've read online is basically the IRS, when it comes to which tax code to choose, whether it's S Corp or LLC or whatever, it seems like to me the IRS takes S Corp way more serious than they do LLC or sole proprietor. And so from what I'm understanding is basically if you want the IRS to leave you alone, get an S Corp. I don't know.
And so it's levels of separation from you as an individual. So if you can be a DBA, a doing business as, and just file as part of your personal taxes. However, like if something happened and you didn't have insurance or if somebody like slipped and fell outside of your house, well, your house is part of your, you know, your individual assets. And that can be included if there was some sort of settlement. When you have like an LLC, a limited liability corporation or LLC, limited liability partnership, you're starting to separate your personal assets from the business assets. Going to a corporation separates it even more because the LLC, LLPs, it's kind of like everything is your business is filing its own tax return, but the profit that you're making from that is passing through to your personal return. And so my husband and I were equal partners, and so we filed jointly, and it's like a whole thing. But so we have some benefits because we're able to write off certain percentages of our home bills. And Quincy had mentioned it in the comments. There's usually a cap on how much of your square footage, but it like in my state, I think it's about at a third. You could like can write off a third of our mortgage, a third of our utilities, like a third of things, because we for both personal and for business. But then some things we can write off as a total expense. Like I have a separate phone and phone line for the business. So obviously that's not the same as my personal phone. But then you have, when you go to a corporation, you're paying yourself more as an employee. And so once you reach a certain threshold, hold of how much the business is bringing in, a lot of times the benefits and protections of being an S corp and the different tax write-offs that are separate for corporations will outweigh the fact that you're paying more in taxes on your personal income. So when you're an LLC and it's passing through to your personal income, you're basically paying self-employment taxes, right? Your business is not covering the part of the taxes that if you were an employee, the employer would pay. But when you're an S corp and you're paying yourself like an employee, the business is taking on some of that taxes. So then you personally don't owe as much. So it's a lot of nuance, and a lot of times you have to reach a certain level of how much the business is making in order to reach those tax benefits to offset the fact that you're literally, the business is paying some of your taxes, but then you also have your personal taxes to cover as well, instead of you just paying self-employment taxes. So it's definitely something you want to talk to a tax professional in your area. The one that I go to previously worked for like 20 years at the state of New Jersey in their tax department, and he has a home-based business. So he knows everything I need him to know in order to file and do our taxes correctly. We do pay more than going, like if you were a business and you had a more complicated return, don't just go to like the H&R Block or like the kind of the inexpensive ones, because you want someone who is more of a specialized professional to make sure you're getting as much of the benefit as possible. And like Julie was saying, when you first open a business, there's a lot of additional benefits, especially in that first year. And you can even take a loss for the first couple of years, which is good for how much you have to pay in taxes, but bad if you're trying to build your credit or trying to buy a house under, or trying to buy like a mobile van under your business, because then it's not actually showing you're making any money. So there's a lot of things, and you want to make sure you talk to a tax professional, because all of us are going to have different situations to make sure what's going to be best for yours. And also think about liability. So we do some, so I do students and things. And originally I had a separate LLC and a separate business we were doing those under, but we've now decided to do it under our primary business one, because that has the bigger liability insurance umbrella. So we're doing, instead of paying insurance twice, we're doing it all under one. And so that was just, and Tanya says too much math. I know. That's why I pay someone to do it.
Yeah. The dog groomer brain in me is like, wow. It's a lot. And so any of y'all that are watching, this is exactly why, just like people pay us to groom their animals, this is why we pay people, professionals, to do that tax stuff. Look, I know plenty of dog groomers and cat groomers out there that are great at making an animal look beautiful, but I can almost guarantee you most of us groomers suck when it comes to business and finances. This is why we're all struggling so much. So I know there's a groomer on Facebook. I think it's called the Savvy Pet Groomer or Savvy Groomer. She's also on YouTube, but just look it up. And she explains a lot of this stuff. But if you're still blown away by all these numbers, just talk like Lynn said. Just talk to a tax professional. And because every single city, every single county, every single state is different, just a little bit, just enough to piss you off.
So, are you guys allowed to have employees technically if you want them?
I can't. I cannot.
I can't, well, unless they live at my house, and I'm not letting other people live here. So
they don't have to live at my house. I can have, like, I think it was up to like 3 family members at my old location, and I can have 2 family members in my home, but I can have 2 employees at this location.
Yeah. Do they have to be family?
It can be family and non-family for me.
They don't want to keep this to stuff in school, y'all.
Like, I'm in the same county, but each city has their own rules too. And like, people think like, oh, just because my friend in the city over can do it means I can do it. And it's like, no, like my friend who is on here, Christy, her and I are side by side, and her rules are different than my rules. Like, it's so crazy.
Yeah.
Not that I want an employee. I just wondered, because I thought that was kind of wild that they have to live here to work for me.
Yeah, she just said she can't have employees in the chat.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Ours for home-based business. So if you're looking up your ordinances, a lot of times they use the term home occupation. So if you're like searching through ordinances and you're trying to figure out if you can do this, home occupation is a lot of times when it's listed under. So in mine, if they had let me do the conditional use permit
I would be listed as a home occupation. And that does not allow you to have employees that don't live on site. So kind of Kate and Quincy, what you guys were saying, it doesn't have to be family, but they have to live in the household. However, because I have a use variance, the rules start getting a little murky. Yeah. Like nobody called the city, but it's one of those things that I found, unless you are selling your house or unless you are applying for a permit, our municipality doesn't come and check anything. So
I could pay somebody under the table all day long if I wanted them.
I don't know if I
you could do a lot of stuff under the table all day long.
Don't do it.
No, we don't advise that. Just because you can doesn't mean you should.
Exactly.
Thank you. I was like, all the family here, grooming here, with me, and I can tell you guys bye any time of the day I want.
Right. But a lot, I've also found that what is happening, so a lot of government entities do not talk to each other. So the IRS and the state business registry for businesses and your local municipality that's doing zoning, they're not talking to each other. So if you're paying all your taxes, the IRS is happy. If you got the zoning all figured out, well, then zoning is happy. But I mean, I can register my business and not even have to show them anything from those other two entities, except that, oh yeah, I have my EIN from, you know, from the IRS. And so a lot of times, like, they may not say, it might be like, oh, well, this one let me register. And it's like, well, that one doesn't check all of the other stuff. So just know that there's these different entities, and sometimes they don't, well, a lot of times they don't talk to each other. And a lot of times it can take several years for them to come back to you. So like the IRS is very behind on like double checking all the figures and stuff. So just know that, like, so a friend of mine had an audit, and he's not a groomer, he's not related, but he was audited and they found he was trying to write off more expenses than he should have been for his business. And they went back, I think, 10 years, and he had six figures he had to pay back because they do holding interest on the fine, and it starts back from when you should have paid it, not like today, from back there. So they did work with him. He was on a payment plan, and I think he's about paid off by now, but just know, like, the IRS definitely takes stuff seriously, but then your local municipality is the one that can actually close you down. And they can actually say, no, you cannot operate a business out of this location if you didn't go through the proper channels. However, having been through all of the difficult channels, a lot of people will just do it and then be like, oh, you know, I'm going to do it for 10, 15 years before I get caught. And then it's like, oh, well, I guess I'm closed now. So a lot of people just do it without going through everything, which then makes it harder for the people who are going through the correct channels, because now the municipality has no idea what they're doing. So it's a double-edged sword.
I love you, Lynn. I love learning from Lynn, you guys. It's so great. She's fantastic.
I love this. It's very informative.
I saw a great question that kind of got pulled up that we answered earlier, and said, when being approved by your local zoning, did they inspect your home? For me, my home was supposed to be inspected, but they just never came. What about the rest of you guys?
They never asked me.
Nope.
The
only questions were like building construction stuff. Like if I was filing for like electrical permits, they will come and look.
Insurance did, because I claimed my roof the first year. The icicles from having that room heated ripped my roof off.
Oh, damn.
So the insurance came.
Insurance is the only one that come out and actually look.
And he just said, like, yep, that was
but ice, they don't look for the guy. Stuff that what the city would be looking for. So they're just, they look for a totally different thing. They don't care. So our entire point of all this stuff, y'all, is when it comes to the finances and the LLC and all that stuff, just get a professional or marry one like Lynn did.
Mark, she was thinking.
I needed someone who was
calling Lynn now.
So I hung around the bars. No, I'm kidding. I didn't hang around the bars. But he did say he was an attorney, and I was like,
we got any more questions? Let's see. I would have married a plumber.
That's a great one.
I mean, for me, my husband and I We're kind of like a jack of all trades. Not that we're experts by any means. But we built our whole salon minus mudding the drywall because I hate that.
Drywall sucks.
My best friend's boyfriend painted for us for free as a Christmas gift.
Oh, that's nice.
Do they want to be other than that, we did everything our own. And it was already technically plumbed and technically drained.
That's awesome.
We redid the entire electrical, and he only zapped himself twice. I got myself once, so no big deal.
Oh,
any business books we recommend?
I like Lynn.
Lynn, here we go.
I feel like that's such a broad question. I'm curious, aspect of business are you wanting to know?
Yeah.
The best business book that I would recommend, I was literally talking about it yesterday with the students here in the cat grooming school. And it is a book that I've read multiple times. It's a super easy read, and I think everybody should read it, even if you're currently an employee and you don't own your business yet. And it's called The E-Myth by Michael Gerber. And it stands for The Entrepreneurial Myth. And it talks about how in a business, there are three roles. And this is not people, this is roles. There's the entrepreneur, there's the manager, and there's the technician. And as an individual who owns their own business, we have to be all three of those roles. So the entrepreneur is the one that has all the big visions for the business, right? We're planning what we want it to look like in the next 5, 10+ years. And then the manager is the role that takes the big vision and they're going to break it down into like day-to-day responsibilities. They're looking at what happened last week and comparing it to this week's numbers. They're kind of in the middle ground. And then the technician is the one that's doing the actual stuff in your business. So in grooming, it's the actual grooming. Now, when we're an employee, we are the technician in another business. But what happens when we open our own businesses, we don't absorb and take on the other two roles. So we're literally just a technician run business, and we are neglecting the other responsibilities of being a business owner, and also why business is not just for everybody. And so right. I really like really quick read, and it breaks down how to identify the different tasks in your business and making sure what roles are you identifying with and what your strengths are. Like, I'm a natural manager, but I really struggle with the entrepreneur tasks because I have a hard time coming up with like the big vision, big ideas. But then I've worked for people who are great entrepreneurs, so I can learn from them. And I always think that the first step of growth is self-awareness. So if you don't know what the problem is, there's no hope of trying to grow from it or fix it. The book is called The E-Myth. I think the one right now is called The E-Myth Revisited. And the author is Michael Gerber.
Best book. E is in the letter?
The E is the letter. It's like E-Myth. And I read it several times. And every time I read it, I get different stuff out of it because I'm at a different point in my life. And so just general, if you're interested in owning a business, or if you just started a business, or you've been in business for a long time and you just want kind of what could I possibly be doing differently? It's a great entry level book. And it's like this big. It's going to take you like a day to get through it.
Is that right? E-Myth, Michael Gerber.
Yes, I see. Yep. That is correct.
Sweet.
Also, well, I was going to say, for those of you who like do ebooks and all that stuff, like I'll probably find that on ebook, but I like finding like podcasts. Like when I groom, I go through cycles. I go through music, then I go like through, I watch TV shows I've seen before just in my headphones. But I've realized like I've just found like podcasts, and I find people like whose like caption captures me, and I've listened to that and I've learned some great things. I did do a year of this, only a year, but still like a college, was a business degree until I found grooming and stuff. So like even finding like local classes and stuff, there are like continued ed classes like all over too that you can find if you're looking for like business stuff like that too. But I'm excited to read the book. Well, listen, I'm gonna listen to the book, let's be honest. I don't read.
Podcasts are read.
Like when people are like books, I'm like, oh, not me.
Yeah, I'm not a reader either, but I'm more of a personal development person. I watch a lot of videos and listen to a lot of stuff, and stuff to just help my entire life, like Dr. Eric Thomas, Les Brown, Steve Harvey, a lot of those personal development people, like They all say the same stuff, but they say it in a different way. It hits you differently. And it's helped me. So, and I think that's why I'm more of the entrepreneurial person in that whole e-myth thing that you were just talking about. But I suck at managing. I'm the worst manager.
To be honest, a lot of people do.
I'm good at math, but math on the spot, when somebody wants change, and I do like $5, $10 amounts, y'all. Like, math on the spot freaking kills me sometimes. They'll hand me like $120 on a $75. I'm like, what?
Yeah, so. All right, we got any more last minute questions before we say deuces out this piece?
Recommendation, and it's because NC said it, and it's more of a technical recommendation. If you are working on your website, there is a really fantastic podcast, and he also has a book, and he's got videos, and it's Donald Miller Story Brand, and he talks about structuring your business and like your phrasing and things like that. But the best thing that I like about a lot of his podcasts, especially if you start at the very beginning, at the end of almost every episode, he does a website review of one of the attendees at one of his live events. And he uses what he calls the grunt test. And it is because, you know, when you first go to a business, I think statistically, it's like you have 3 seconds before that person leaves your website. So you have to communicate a lot of information very, very quickly. And Donald Miller talks about the grunt test, as in, if a caveman or cave person looked at your website, could they grunt out what it is that you do in a few seconds?
I like and
that. I know it's really interesting. And you hear him, and he does all different kinds of businesses, like landscaping businesses and photography businesses. And it's so interesting how he structures everything. And it's really simple changes that you can make on your website. And I look at a lot of groomer websites, a lot. It's something I'm very interested in. And so many of them don't have their website, or they don't have their location on it. They don't say what they do, where they service, why you should go to them. Like, they don't have a lot of information. And this is a great, simple way to kind of revamp your website, which you should be doing on the regular, like not a full revamp, but Google likes active stuff. So you want your website to have some changes occasionally. And so I really love listening to his talks, and especially starting all the way at the beginning. So it's called Story Brand. It's all one word, Donald Miller.
I want to chime in on the end of that, because you said your website, also your social media accounts. Most groomers do. Listen, you don't have to have your address. Like, if you don't want your address, that's fine. But what area do you service? Like, literally, I was looking for a hairstylist today, and I was going through Instagrams, and not any of them even say what state they're in. And I'm like, where are you? Like, are you in Utah, or are you in California, or are you like in Scotland? Like, you need to like say like serving like this county, or like you can put your location and say like, I can say I'm South Weber, Utah. Like that also, not just your website, but your socials, for the people who don't even bother to look at your website. Because there are those people who are like, ooh, a groomer, cool. I'm just going to message them, even though it says don't direct message me. Like, right? So, sorry. Had to tag that.
That reminds me. Hey, I need to put my Midwest City on my profile.
Please do. Please. Freaking keep forgetting. Do. Please. Like, for so, I didn't want to cut anybody off, but I'm going to let y'all go. Thank you so much for having me. But I got to feed these hellions.
Okay, see ya.
You're good, see ya.
But let's see.
Now we're gonna
As far as website go, I wanna point something out. I don't know if y'all follow Pearly Paws on TikTok or Instagram, whatever, but her website is actually really good. I checked out her link tree, and she has her website in there. And I don't know, I think it looks really good, but then I messaged her, and I think she said that she hired a company to do it. So I might be hiring a company to do it. Can I try doing it myself on like Wix? And I'm just like, this is not for me. So, but check it out.
And it's a lot of behind the scenes stuff if you want to use like search engine optimization. Like, ideally Wix, like I use Squarespace because I think it's really easy. I love drag and drop kind of stuff, which is Wix is one of those. It's not the best when it comes to customization or having like the search engine optimization stuff, like WordPress is really like key on that one. But honestly, like WordPress to me is like so much, like just my head explodes. And I want to be able to make changes to my website. So even if I did have somebody design it for me, I always want to make sure that I learn enough to be able to go in and like make little changes instead of having to pay somebody to do it. But it's also a timing thing. Like how much time do you have to dedicate to a website? It might just be better. There's a great gal I've worked with, Pet Marketing Unleashed. Oh, I forget her name. But she's got great pet care websites, designs and branding that she does. Really fantastic. And I enjoyed working with her. And I another gal for my revamped logo from the UK, Pet and Ink Designs. And she was fantastic. And sometimes you just got to let the professionals do their magic.
Yeah. So these people are saying that they don't have a website and it's a waste of money on top of things. And, you know, I used to think that too, until I went to the Pet Expo in Dallas this past September. And I was like, I don't want to waste my time and energy on a website. And then the lady that was giving the class, she was like, okay, what happens if TikTok just disappears one day? What happens if Facebook stops? What happens when YouTube shuts down? Your entire social media presence is gone. You know, so the best thing you can do about your business is own all aspects of your business. So create a website and then put all your social media accounts on that. If you want to have like a blog or whatever, do that on your website. Bring the traffic to your website. That's kind of the whole point of it. You can still use all of the social media platforms, no problem. But I think that we all do need a website because, I mean, it's a lot more professional.
I disagree.
I have a website, but I don't even utilize it that well. So I'm just learning.
I'm not against websites. Let me
what happens if it shuts down?
Okay, let's say right now, okay, we lose all social media. It's gone, right? No TikTok, no Instagram, nothing. Remember earlier I said my clients fill out a form every year? It comes with their name, phone number, address,
right? And
email, which you also remember earlier,
Julie, the email list
talked about here. So I personally don't care about a website, but that's for me because A, I'm not taking new clients. I haven't been taking new clients for 7 years. So I stopped when I got to a point that I was booked out with clients and I had done my connection. I personally am not worried about it. But if you are someone who like, I feel like Lynn's is a little bit different because mm-hmm. of your niche. I feel like a website for her is important. Now, Kelsey Ann, who's on here, who has a staff of multiple people, freaking have a website because you have multiple people you are taking care of. But if you plan to be solo and all that stuff, and a website is something you know you can't take care of, don't freaking have one. Find other ways to have an email list and instead have that so then you can start emailing your people. That's just me. And that's the joy of this, right? We all do things different.
Well, I think both of those things are valid because I know plenty of groomers who have a website that don't have an email list and don't have a database of their clients. And so to me, if I want to reach out to my existing clients, I don't use social media for that unless it's just fun stuff. So if I have like announcements or anything important, it's going through email. But like let's say social media all goes away. It doesn't even have to be all social media. I mean, Frizzell, you got banned this morning.
Yeah.
It could be a drop of a hat. And now what if you are in the process of trying to attract new clients? It wouldn't matter if you have your current client's email. If you're still trying to attract new clients, you can get banned. You can lose access. I've met plenty of people that have lost access to their Facebook pages because of a disgruntled.
Or people hack it.
Mm-hmm. Or they hack it. The social media companies decide to change their algorithms and how everything works. So if I'm going to use it to attract new clients, I prefer to diversify a little bit. So that's why I have social media, but I have decided like this is my one little revenue kind of aspect. I also think like I completely understand where people are saying, and Quincy, I get it, like where you're like closing down your clientele. I personally feel that a business needs to have roughly 5 to 10% new clients on a rotating type of business so that you can actively replace the ones that have moved away. Like I've had at least 12 cats pass away this past year due to age. And a lot of it was, I was taking a lot of elderly cats when I first opened. And so now they're all kind of phasing out and I have to fill those spaces. Luckily, a lot of cat people will just get more cats. And so it, or, oh, I have one cat and here's the two new kittens I got. And I'm like, oh, okay, wonderful. That made that easy. But I do feel that there's this kind of rotating new openings that I like to have just to keep everything fresh and running smoothly. And Julie had mentioned it earlier about having flexibility. Flexibility is also something I value in my business because I don't want to be locked into dates very far in advance. So I will book maximum 2 appointments out because I like to have, I want to go on vacation. I want to go on another cruise. Quincy, are we going to go on a cruise, another pet groomer cruise?
Absolutely. Because that was,
we're going to go on, everybody should come. The pet groomer cruises, but I like to have, you know, I can block off extra days. I can move stuff around. So I value flexibility a lot. And so I don't like a lot of standing appointments mixed in with my regular ones. And then like Kelsey is saying, you just raise your prices. Just raise them up or adjust things, or I'll stop booking clients that don't really fit in with my goals for my business where it is. And so I can make other.
Absolutely.
That's what's awesome about what we do. There's multiple different ways to do it. So, you know, absolutely love what we do. So let's see. I think that's about it. Yeah.
Sorry, I'm ready.
All right, I don't see any questions. So
it's,
we're going to have an episode 3.
But it was,
What?
What's Lynn saying?
Somebody was asking about the last groomer cruise. She said, I heard that it wasn't great. I was there. Kelsey Ann was one of the speakers. The speakers were great. So it was like Jody Murphy, Jonathan David, Elizabeth Gibbs, Alyssa Kasiba, and Kelsey Ann Sexton. They were wonderful. The boat was wonderful. The food was wonderful. The places we went to were wonderful. I just think it's a new company and they just have some things they need to adjust. So I had a great time. And if they make some changes, I would go to another one. But I know that Barkley, that's been around for a long time, they just announced their cruise in September. They're going to Bermuda.
And they have some big things changing with their cruise, too. Like, they realized the person who was running it, it seems like, they've replaced her and have some awesome things coming. But also, I was not on the cruise Lynn and Kelsey were on. I was very jealous. You guys, it's a freaking cruise, okay? Who cares that there weren't vendors? Who cares that there were not dogs? How often can you do a vacation for work that is on a cruise that you can write off? You can write it off. So the people who are complaining, I don't freaking care if the guy didn't deliver anything he said. You're on a cruise to the Bahamas. Why are y'all complaining? I was like, I saw all the complaints in my mind blown. I'm like, I would have totally been on that cruise. No problem. Shut your mouth. Like, and it's the first year. So it will be so much. They'll improve.
Like if I showed up at like a broken down houseboat that they had like written in crayon, like groomer cruise on the back, I probably would have been way more suspect. But this, like it's right? through Royal Caribbean. So you know that the cruise is going to be legit anyway. And so then
you, and if you hate the groomer side, just don't go there.
So did the whole cruise have nothing but groomers or
no, it was a cruise. We were just like it's like you can do like a group block. So we booked certain areas that were private events. So they would do like we all had dinner in the same area together. They had the seminars were separate, like you couldn't just like walk in off the boat. But I think the boat is like 3,000 people, 3,200 people.
But we should all go and then do the our freaking hangout and be like, come and meet us and come hang out with us.
We're all yes.
Come on, that's a freaking great idea and you know it.
Come on, you're rocking out.
We're going.
Well, I'm going to Cancun in July, so that's where I'm going.
In November. So
good for you.
Yeah, it's been me and my wife's four year anniversary.
Oh, happy
congratulations.
Yeah. She's giving me the eye, the wife eye right now because she's hungry. So I'm going to have to end this thing so I don't feed my wife.
in trouble.
Yeah. So anyways, y'all, we're going to have episode 3. We have a couple more questions that, you know, awesome Lynn just decided to type out for us, and
she's the best.
It's awesome. Yep. So we're gonna have episode 3. We'll let you know the date soon. But thanks for watching, and I will take this video, edit it, and upload it on the YouTube channel. And yeah, thank y'all for watching. I really appreciate it. So
thanks, everybody. Thanks for putting us all together. Bye.